fellow Southern Virginia students, faculty, and staff, we are grateful for your continued support of The Fading Point. After months of deliberation, we as a group are pleased to announce our new name. For the very first time at Southern Virginia University, your very own Accolade.
Improved or something. I don't know, it was fantastic. You guys need a guitar player? No, that defeats the whole purpose. Thank you very much, Accolade. Looking forward to hearing more. This is kind of jumping out of a box. The program here says unscripted introduction of David Cox and Fran MacDonnell. I could not follow a script even if there was a really great script written out here. We all know these two gentlemen and scholars. I can begin and say that they are both eminently educated, published scholars who have gained attention as scholars in their own right. We know them as teachers here, beloved teachers. And for me, the best of friends. were I to say a few things by way of introduction, they've both served as teachers of my own children. They have been the best of teachers. They will always be remembered fondly by my children, and for that reason, they will always be remembered fondly by me. I'm grateful to them. I love them both and admire them more than I can say. Today we get to hear them speak on issues relating to the life of Dr. Martin Luther King and the Civil Rights Movement. We will first hear from Professor Fran MacDonnell, after which Professor David Cox will speak as well. We'll then, at that point, have a benediction offered by Professor Fran MacDonnell. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Provost Ransfield, and thanks, David. Also great to be speaking with my friend and colleague, David Cox, today. This is Black History Month, February, and the African American experience stands at the heart of the American experience. And in the next 20 minutes or so, I want to talk about a major figure in the civil rights movement, Martin Luther King. And I'll be picking up here on some of the themes that President Wilcox addressed about Dr. King closer to the King holiday. The Martin Luther King American culture knows today is a respectable, reassuring consensus figure. The man who uttered high-sounding quotes that look great on a wall poster in a college dorm or on an SVU faculty member's office. Injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. Who could disagree with such sentiments? King can easily be transformed into an anodyne hero who vaguely stands for ideals of peace, equality, and love, but doesn't really demand all too much from us today. In his own time, he was divisive, he rattled cages, he staked out radical views on economics and foreign policy, and when it came to religion, he believed that God spoke to him. In the next 20 minutes or so, as I said, I'd like to talk to you about King's radicalism, about his philosophy of love, and about the relevance of his life for America in 2017 and for Southern Virginia University. On economics, King frequently expressed dissatisfaction with income inequality and injustices in American capitalism. He praised Scandinavian nations that followed redistributive tax policies. He called for a guaranteed national income. In graduate school, he held that the capitalist system was predicated on exploitation, prejudice, and poverty. In his own life, he lived modestly. When he won the Nobel Prize, he gave away all the money to the civil rights movement, much to the exasperation of his wife. And that's true. King said, "We Americans need to move from being a things-oriented society to a persons-oriented society." On foreign policy matters, he angered many friends of civil rights by coming out forcefully against the war in Vietnam. So forcefully that many of his friends felt that his anti-war messages sounded like a script from Radio Hanoi. That was the headquarters of the North Vietnamese Communist State. However, for King, there was a link between religious faith and his fight against racism, poverty, and militarism. You know what? I forgot about my slides. So there we go. There's MLK at the March on Washington. And there he is, right at the time of the Montgomery bus boycott. More on that shortly. King grew up in Atlanta. He had a privileged background. He was the son of a minister in a prosperous middle-class family. He went to the elite African-American school, Morehouse College, then off to Crozier Seminary in Philadelphia, and finally to Boston University, where he earned a PhD in theology. His thinking was shaped by a number of individuals, and I'm not going to go through all of them, but some reformers from the beginning of the 20th century, like Walter Rauschenbusch, some mid-century theologians like Reinhold Niebuhr. He was very much influenced by the Indian reformer Mohandas Gandhi, who had adopted nonviolent lawbreaking in an effort to win independence for India. But if you go to the King Center in Atlanta and look on their website, other than his mother and father, the individual that most shaped King's life was Jesus Christ. King's Christianity, though, wasn't comfortable or convenient or conventional, and in some ways it's a little scary. At 26-year-old guy, there he is, 26. Some of you might out there might be 26. He landed a plum, cushy position as the minister of the toniest African-American church in Montgomery, Alabama, the Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. When the controversy surrounding Montgomery's buses began in December 1955, segregation on the buses, a number of other individuals were at the head of the boycott. King, however, was drawn into the boycott because some of the civil rights leaders just didn't like each other and couldn't get along, and King seemed like a reasonable person to be the face of the movement. He didn't push for the job, and he wasn't sure he really wanted it. And by the way, the initial boycott was really tame in Montgomery. All African Americans were not insisting on full desegregation. They only wanted the bus company to assure that a black rider in the back of the bus would not have to give up his or her seat to a newly arrived white rider. When Rosa Parks took her seat at first, she was in the black section of the bus. However, the Jim Crow rules insisted that African Americans surrender their seats so that whites would never have to stand. City officials and bus companies refused to compromise on this practice. In an effort to force concessions, African Americans stopped patronizing the local bus company. At this point, King played a major role in a carpooling operation to help Montgomery boycotters get to work. In January 1956, he got arrested for the first time. Going 30 miles per hour in a 25 mile per hour zone, said the local police. The police then put up bureaucratic roadblocks to the payment of his bail because they wanted to intimidate him, they wanted to humiliate him, and they kept him in jail overnight. Montgomery officials incarcerated him, surrounded by criminals. When he went home, MLK went home the next day, he started receiving frightening and profane phone calls threatening his family. He wanted out of leadership. He wanted to go back to the ordinary life of a pastor of a well-heeled church. At this point in his memoirs, he recalls a very dramatic conversion experience where he believed that God spoke directly to him. And I'm gonna read the passage. I find it very striking. This is Dr. King. He's just been released from jail. He's getting threats. I sat there and thought about a beautiful little daughter who had just been born. She was the darling of my life. I'd come in night after night and see that little gentle smile. And I sat at the table thinking about that little girl and thinking about the fact that she could be taken away from me at any minute. And I started thinking about a dedicated, devoted, and loyal wife who was over there asleep, and she could be taken away from me, or I could be taken away from her. And I got to the point that I couldn't take it any longer. I was weak. Something said to me, you can't call on Daddy now. He's up in Atlanta, 175 miles away. You can't even call on Mama now. I prayed a prayer, and I prayed out loud that night. I said, Lord, I'm down here trying to do what's right. I think I'm right. I think the cause that we represent is right. But Lord, I must confess that I'm weak now. I'm faltering. I'm losing my courage. And I can't let the people see me like this, because if they see me weak and losing my courage, they will begin to get weak. And it seemed at that moment that I could hear an inner voice saying to me, Martin Luther, stand up for righteousness, stand up for justice, stand up for truth. I heard the voice of Jesus saying, still to fight on. He promised never to leave me alone, never to leave me alone. No, never alone, never alone. He promised never to leave me alone. Pretty powerful. Just a few days after that experience, King's front porch was bombed. 2 years later, after the bus boycott had succeeded, King's front door was fired upon by a shotgun. In 1958, he was stabbed in a New York City department store. During a September 1962 speech in Birmingham at the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, an American Nazi punched the civil rights leader in the face several times. King responded to this attack with calm and did not strike back, and his physical courage in this episode was sort of awe-inspiring to those around him. And in the end, of course, King ended up losing his life in the fight for civil rights. He was murdered, assassinated on April 4th, 1968 in Memphis. He was 39 years old, and it's hard to believe if he was alive now, he'd be 88. I mean, he could still easily, right? We know people we love who are 88 that are around. There's his family. So I'm from Boston, and the Boston Irish have a prayer, and it goes like this. Many of you out there who are from Boston will recognize this. May those who love us, and those who don't love us, may God turn their hearts. But if he won't turn their hearts, may he turn their ankles so we can identify them by their limping. It's a pretty funny prayer, and it's all Boston, but it really underscores how hard it is to really love your enemies. And that's one of the things about King, and this is something the president talked about a month ago, that is really impressive. King really believed in Christ's message in Matthew, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, pray for them that despitefully use you. MLK said that his work rested on agape, a distinct kind of love. He called agape the understanding, creative, redemptive goodwill for all men. It is a love that seeks nothing in return. It's an overflowing love. It's what theologians would call the love of God working in the lives of men. And when you rise to love on this level, you begin to love men, King said, not because they are likable, but because God loves them. You look at every man and you love him because you know God loves him, and he might be the worst person you've ever seen. King warned that hate always distorts the personality of the hater. For the hater, true becomes false, and false becomes true. Now, MLK wasn't a perfect person. In many ways, he failed. He failed as a father and as a husband. He, as a dad leading the civil rights movement, he was frequently away from his kids. As a husband, he frequently broke his marriage vows. Historian William O'Neill writes, King was human and therefore imperfect. His judgment was sometimes flawed. Worse still, he was promiscuous, which we know because the FBI, to its everlasting shame, spied upon his bed. King's adulteries endangered the movement, wounded his loyal wife and family, and worst of all, perhaps in his own eyes, were sinful. There can be no excuse for them. Yet, and this is O'Neill, it may be that his weakness made him sympathetic to the failings of others. In fighting racism, he always condemned the sin and not the sinner. Though acclaimed by the world and laden with honors, King never became arrogant. Warts and all, King was a great American, one of the greatest ever, the glory of his time. King's resort to lawbreaking also marked the radicalism of the movement. And let me just see, there we got that, there's that prayer, you don't need to see that, okay. There's old Henry David Thoreau, obviously an inspiration to MLK with his call for conscientious lawbreaking, but MLK put a much more sort of social twist on this. Thoreau was only worried about, like, wow, I can't be tainted as an individual by breaking a law. MLK was concerned about improving the community and the society when there were immoral laws. So a couple of comments on his nonviolent civil disobedience. King got arrested 30 times, and he was jailed 29 times. But he never repudiated America. He celebrated the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. He found allies in the system. At times, the Kennedys helped, especially Robert Kennedy. And LBJ, Lyndon Baines Johnson, brought to pass the most sweeping advances in civil rights and voting rights. However, when he needed to, he believed in challenging the existing power structure and peacefully breaking the law. I see my colleagues John Wallen and James Lambert right in front of me. I know that in the college composition class that many of you are taking, you will have read King's famous letter from a Birmingham jail. And here he spells out in great detail when he thinks it's appropriate to break a law. So a number of white ministers had written to King, scolding him for breaking the law. They told King, you need to be patient. Like, people's hearts, they change over time. Just wait. You got to work within the system. King's letter responded to those ministers by saying, freedom is never given voluntarily by the oppressor, and history only advances through the efforts of men and women willing to be co-workers with God. He said that hundreds of years of waiting had not brought racial justice. Those who said wait really meant never. King spelled out a rigorous three-step process before any lawbreaking should occur. And it should only occur over a serious matter, not because the Virginia legislature passed a safety belt rule and you don't want to be told to wear a safety belt in your car or not. So he was not like break the law at the drop of a hat. Any law, he thought, that degraded the human personality and distorted the soul, or any law that the majority didn't have to follow, but a minority had to follow, that would be a kind of law that ought to be violated. Any law that violated the Constitution, that kind of a law ought to be violated. King's three-step process for lawbreaking said, first off, you have to look and investigate and see if there's an unjust law. You have to figure that out. Second, if there is an unjust law, you go to the local authorities and you try to work things out. You negotiate, you talk with them. You see, can we solve it without lawbreaking? And then lastly, and this is the most important step in King's process for when direct action is just another word for civil disobedience, should take place, you had to go through a process of self-purification. And that meant self-scrutiny. What are my motivations? That meant that you needed to be willing, whatever happened, to stay nonviolent, and that you had to accept the consequences of breaking that law. Only after all three of these steps did MLK endorse direct action. Okay, so I'm coming into the home stretch here. What should King mean for us today? So some of you students out there have had me before know I'm a giant fan of Bono and U2, not just as artists, but Bono as a human being. In 2004, Bono gave an amazing, hilarious, deeply humane commencement address at the University of Pennsylvania. In this talk, he said that America was different than his beloved Ireland. America, he said, was not just a country, it was an idea. Bono said, the idea of America rested in the belief that anything was possible, that the future was fluid, that every human life had equal worth, that all men and women are created equal. He said to truly be an American was to betray the age. Betray the age. What did he mean by that? He meant every era, he said, had its lies, its moral blind spots, its phony certitudes. For MLK, the phony certitudes of his own time were segregation, consumerism, and militarism. I don't think if MLK was alive today in 2017, he would say every American had to choose his issues as the focal point of their own reform efforts, though it certainly is honorable to fight for peace, economic justice, and racial equality. MLK today challenges all of us to find one lie that society perpetrates, a lie that undermines the dignity of individual life. King challenges us to shine a light on a moral blind spot of our own time, to betray the age. King acknowledged that the whole civil rights movement depended on an army of dedicated men and women of all races ready to betray the age. And David, Professor Cox, is going to speak about one such individual shortly. In 1966, Robert Kennedy, a great friend to King and to civil rights, offered a wonderful address in South Africa. And I want to read that to you, a little bit of it. RFK said, "It is from numberless diverse acts of courage and belief that human history is shaped. Each time a man stands up for an ideal or acts to improve the lot of others, or strikes out against injustice, he sends forth a tiny ripple of hope. And crossing each other from a million different centers of energy and daring, these ripples build a current that can sweep down the mightiest walls of oppression and resistance. The Kennedys knew how to give a speech. I love RFK's image of a ripple of hope, because a ripple, after all, doesn't seem like too much to ask for. If I'm being honest about my own social activism in the last 20 years, I'm at a quarter of a ripple. I'm not quite sure, not at a whole ripple. But I can look around this campus and be inspired by lots of ripples of hope. I have colleagues here who spent the summer helping flood victims in West Virginia, other faculty colleagues and staff, administrative colleagues, who feed the hungry on a regular basis through the good works of the community table. I've got a colleague here who teaches those imprisoned in jails. I have students. I see a student over there who's about to go off on a RAM trip. Students who devote weekends to providing medical and dental care to the indigent. Students who serve as counselors for the victims of domestic abuse at Project Horizon. Students who volunteer in the local schools. So maybe at the start of this new year, sort of, it's February, these great examples, these ripples of hope in Buena Vista can help me get headed down a road MLK would approve of. The great Southern writer Flannery O'Connor says in one of her very scary stories that a soul is like a car. It's always driving in one direction or the other. I think MLK would tell us if we're driving our souls in the right direction, we ought to have the courage. Let me see if I can move this one. There we go. I don't know if you recognize those two. That's two wonderful history students who graduated last year, Colin Smith and Lauren Hafen. Last year, I walked out my front door in Lexington and saw a piece of trash on the ground, and I picked it up and I showed it to my wife, and it was a Ku Klux Klan leaflet. And they organized a big anti-Klan rally at Hopkins Green, and sort of on their own, these great SVU students, he paid out of our state, Virginia's for Lovers, sort of brought a bunch of students last year over to that anti-Klan rally. I guess what I'd say there is Colin and Lauren are ready to drive 30 miles per hour in a 25 mile per hour zone when it comes to matters of social justice. So that's all I've got to say. I turn things over to David.
Before I begin, I want to check. Accolade, you're playing tomorrow night at Rockapella, aren't you? All right, I got to tell you, last year when you're known as Fading Point, it was a good thing that y'all went last because they had VMI singing and then WNL groups sang and then SVU came on and they rocked. People were walking, yes. People were leaving after it was all over saying, boy, wait, we saved the best for last. They stole the show, and you're going to do that tomorrow night too, aren't you? Come. I want to follow on by telling a story of something of an example of what Dr. MacDonnell has talked about. And as Dr. King had a text, I do too. And it's what I'm sure you know. Greater love has no one that but this, than to lay down his life for a friend. It's an unlikely story that begins in this regard in an unlikely place, and that is the Virginia Military Institute. How many of you have actually been to VMI, to set foot on VMI? How many of you have seen a parade? Oh, not as many. Put that on your bucket list. It's a very impressive experience, but a very unlikely place, particularly back in 1967, when a young man named Johnathon Daniels came to VMI. He had already shown a certain amount of independence when he was in high school. He left the Congregational Church to join the Episcopal Church. That was not really done all that much in that time and that place. But he came to VMI. But what was really odd was that he was from New Hampshire. He was a Yankee in a Southern school that, like this school at the time and every other school in the South, was for whites only, except for those that were for blacks only. It was, in a word, segregated. So that was odd in and of itself, and in fact, the yearbook, after they were all done 4 years later, said that the presence of a New Hampshire Yankee in a Southern military college has for 4 years roused the curiosity of his Dixie colleagues. But he did what VMI cadets do. He went through the rat line. He got over here to date Southern seminary women when he could. He got his class ring, which is a big deal and a big ring. And he did very well in school, so well that he graduated with receiving a impressive fellowship. He's shown here with a number of others who won fellowships. For as a friend of mine who was at VMI at the same time said to me just yesterday, Johnathon Daniels was a cut above everyone else. And the yearbook said, eventually, if admiration was coupled with curiosity, he was elected the valedictorian of his class. That didn't mean he was number one in the class, but he was elected to give the speech. And in that speech to the graduates, he declared, "We have spent 4 years in preparation for something. What that something is, who we are, we do not know. I wish you the joy of a purposeful life," he concluded. "I wish you new worlds and the vision to see them. I wish you the decency and the nobility of which you are capable." With that, he went up on that fellowship to Harvard. Not a shabby school, I'm told, Dr. MacDonnell. He tells me that. I believe him. But he was to study literature, but something else was going on. He was wrestling in a spiritual way. Already I mentioned he had changed denominations. Well, he felt that the Heavenly Caller, Father, was calling him to something more. And so he entered the Episcopal Theological Seminary, which is right next door to Harvard. And you see there with its chapel, where he worshiped every day, in order to, the idea being that he would become an ordained minister, a priest of the Episcopal Church. This was a momentous time in the history of our nation. Just a month before he entered Episcopal Theological Seminary, Dr. King had given his I Have a Dream speech in the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. A year and a half later, Dr. King was pursuing and focusing the civil rights movement. It moved beyond the desegregation of facilities, for Congress had at long last passed the Voting Rights Act. And so it turned to a matter of registering all people to vote, especially those who had been excluded so purposefully by the white Southern order, and no place was worse than Alabama. And so Dr. King, in the April of 1965, asked people to come from all over the nation to come to Alabama to register black people to vote. He and several others responded and went to Selma, where he lived with, he worked with others, including a woman named Judith Upham, who was from the seminary as well. And he lived with a black family in Selma while he was registering people to vote. He was so taken by this that when he returned to Boston, he determined that he would return for the whole summer. So he did. And it's interesting, he reached that conclusion one night after chapel when they sang the Magnificat, the Song of Mary in Luke, "My soul magnifies the Lord." And as God was asking her to do something, so he believed Dr. King, the Lord through Dr. King was asking him to do something. And so, like the prophet Isaiah, he had to say, "Here am I, send me." He went back and was asked to go to Lowndes County. Lowndes County, Bloody Lowndes it was called, because the racism there was so violent that blood was shed by those who dared to defy the established order. They were protesting in town one August day, a couple of segregated stores, when they were arrested. They, being among others, a Roman Catholic priest named Douglas Morris Rowe, and a 15-year-old girl from the area, named an African-American named Ruby Sales. They were taken to, you can see some of the racism there in that. You might not be able to read it, but echoing what Dr. MacDonnell said, this says Martin Luther King Communist Training School. So he decided, and there he was in in Lowndes County with Ruby Sales and Douglas Morris Rowe, and they were taken to this jail in Hayneville. Nobody knew they were arrested. They couldn't call anyone. This was on August the 14th of 1965. They were there for a week. The food, he said to his mother, was vile, and perhaps even worse yet, none of them were allowed to bathe. Suddenly, they were released. That's not a good thing. They were in enemy territory, and no one knew that they were there. So they walked over to a mom and pop store. This picture was taken just a few years ago. Some went to call for help so they can get essentially rescued from there. But meanwhile, Ruby Sales and Johnathon Daniels and Father Morris Rowe and one or two others were going into the store to buy a soda. Ruby was the first one there in front of the mall. And as they walked in and drew close to it, Johnathon Daniels noticed that there was a shotgun on the other side of a screen door. He pulled Ruby Sales out of the way, and just then the blast went off. It basically tore his body in two. And then the shooter turned on Father Morris Rowe, who was running for help, running for safety, and shot him in the back. Johnathon died on the spot. The man's name was Thomas Coleman. He was a construction supervisor and part-time deputy sheriff. He was charged not with murder, but with manslaughter, and was acquitted after about an hour's deliberation by an all-white jury. He said later he would shoot them both tomorrow. Father Morris Rowe survived thanks to a black doctor who ministered to him. He was paralyzed but eventually recovered, but walks with pain every day. I had the opportunity to meet him some years ago. Ruby Sales found a vocation in teaching and serves now as an Episcopal priest, working for justice in Atlanta. As for Johnathon Daniels, it took an act of the President of the United States to release his body for burial. But finally it does. It was in Keene, New Hampshire, his home. Martin Luther King, at the time, said this, that Johnathon Daniels had performed one of the most heroic Christian deeds of which I have heard in my entire ministry. There were honors that have come his way. The Episcopal Church in 1991 added him to its list of essentially heroes and heroines that we remember each year. There is an arch at Virginia Military Institute, an entryway. One is named for George Washington, one for Stonewall Jackson, one for George Marshall, and one for Johnathon Daniels. There's a sculpture in Washington Cathedral, and a monument in Alabama in his home church. But perhaps the most significant of all is in Canterbury Cathedral, which is the mother church of the Anglican Communion. And in that church, there is a chapel of modern martyrs. There are two Americans who are remembered in that chapel. One is Martin Luther King. The other is Johnathon Myrick Daniels. Two final thoughts. Never take the rights we have for granted. People gave their blood to obtain them, to preserve them, or to make sure that they are extended to all of our people. Some die on the battlefield. Some die as Johnathon Daniels did. These rights are precious. They belong to everyone. Johnathon Daniels is one who had it all. But he gave his life in pursuit of those who, by comparison, had nothing. And the other is this. Our Heavenly Father prepares each of us for something. What that something is, and who, we do not know. I pray that he may grant all of you a long and prosperous and peaceful and purposeful life. But I also pray that should you be called upon to stand up for what is right, as Johnathon Daniels found himself doing, and so many others who did so on our behalf, that their Heavenly Father will grant you fearless courage with the decency and the nobility of which you are capable. And in so doing, you may be instruments of his peace.
I'd like to say the closing prayer, the peace prayer of St. Francis, a prayer that embodies the spirit of redemptive love by which MLK, Martin Luther King Jr., lived. As a historian, I have to make one note. It's not entirely clear that St. Francis actually wrote this prayer, but nonetheless, it is a beautiful prayer. Lord, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life.